to the third story. I'm your host, Leo Seeker. Jake Sherman plays piano, and he also sings a lovely song. You really ought to hear him. Attended Berklee, then moved to New York. That's where he knew he would belong, not LA. Jake Sherman was born in Boston. We listen to his dad play harpsichord, classical music. Then he heard a Weird Al Yankovic record, and his life was changed, that's for sure. Jake Sherman, Weird Al Yankovic. Jake Sherman, Jake Sherman also plays harmonica, and he's really very funny too. I dig Jake Sherman, if you can't tell already. Tell me, how about you? I hope you dig him too. As always, check the website for videos and music too. Third-story.com, and Patreon is also cool. Jake Sherman,
welcome to the studio, I guess, the house in
Thank
person.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
As I mentioned to you, you're my third in person since 2020.
Yeah, weird.
It's weird, right? Remembering how to do this.
Right.
Meet new people, going to new places.
Yep.
You keep showing up in unexpected places. As much as I feel like I know you, I think it's hard to pin you down. So I think I want to start with the two images that you lead with in the way you talk about yourself publicly, which is Bach and Weird Al Yankovic.
Oh, yes.
Those are the formative musical memories that you talk about.
Yeah, definitely. My dad is a classical harpsichordist, so I think that's probably my biggest unintentional influence. And Weird Al was the first pop music that I loved. That's the combination that I am, pretty much.
I think the reason it rings so true to me when I think about you is that, like, you're so funny and you're so serious.
Thanks.
You know
nice.
What I mean?
Yeah, that feels great to hear.
Oh, good. I mean, musically, you're like, it's for real. It's really, you really take it seriously on a lot of different instruments in a lot of different ways. And lyrically, you are pretty out there sometimes. Like you, and even just like your presentation, it's like, it's so serious and it's also so surreal.
Cool. I guess that's coming from the Weird Al thing. And just, not, I've been scared about presenting myself as too serious. Maybe as I grow up more, I'll realize that it's okay to be serious sometimes.
How old are you now?
I'm 32. Maybe a bit of that is from fear, but also I just like to be funny. Comedians are an influence, I guess.
What does it mean to grow up when you say maybe when I grow up more?
I've been thinking more about how it's important to just really present what you want to present without many layers, hiding behind many layers. Meshell and Ndegeocello told me I should find out what it's like not to do shtick. And I've been thinking about that a lot and slowly understanding what that means.
Some of the most inspiring images and presentations of yours that I've seen have been the unintentional ones, the captured video from the solo house tour that you did last summer, some video that my friend Alix in Girona sent me of your performance there earlier this year, where all of the artifice was stripped away, probably for economic reasons more than anything else. And it was just you and the music, and it was stunning.
Thank you.
When it was summer, it was all a big deal.
So I think I know what Meshell is talking about when she says, pull away all the stuff.
Yeah.
And what's left may be closer to the authentic you than you realize.
Yeah, definitely. In that Europe tour, I worked through that a lot. It started with this sort of one-man band setup, which I think you that's probably what you saw, with like key bass and hi-hat and bass drum and stuff,
yep.
Which is cool and impressive. But also, towards the end of it, I realized that I could really do the show just playing piano and singing. So that's where I'm at now. I'm trying to really make a full, engaging, hour-long show without anything but a piano.
Yeah. Yeah, I dig it. And you also made this little EP last year where you played piano and right. sang live band, mm-hmm. which was, I think, a step in that direction.
Totally, yeah.
You know it's cold tonight, moon. But I guess it is colder for you. Will we be visiting soon? Lonely up there when you can't see you.
But it's also a step back to kind of where you started. I mean, there's an aspect of your development that's hard to track because there's a period in your life when you really stepped forward as a Hammond organ player.
Yes, definitely.
There's a record that you made with Armin Hirsch at Dizzy's.
Yeah. Oh, you did research.
It's really impressive to hear how devoted you were to the organ.
That's what I wanted to do for years. Yeah. Starting basically when I first heard that instrument when I was like 13, then I was like, okay, that's going to be it. And it wasn't until really part of the way through college that I started realizing there might be a different path.
So where'd you hear it?
I heard it on a funk anthology, and I heard it in the background on John Mayer. Yeah, just like a very background sound, but I was like, ooh, that sounds like a keyboard, but watery.
Did it remind you, or was it evocative of church or gospel, or you didn't necessarily
know what
that was? I didn't
even know gospel music at the time. Just the sound was something I wanted to explore.
So you had heard your dad playing harpsichord at mm-hmm. home.
Yep.
And were you playing piano or anything?
Yeah, yeah.
As a kid?
Yeah, I played piano.
Classical piano?
Yeah, I played Suzuki piano as uh-huh. a kid, and then started getting into ragtime. That was really the first music that was non-classical that I liked.
Your parents listened mostly to classical, or was it
Yeah,
broad?
I'd say mostly to classical, although my dad loves Brazilian music and old jazz also. Mm-hmm.
You hear the organ, and how did you go about figuring out what it was?
I don't know. I think I asked people, and then it became clear what it was, and then I like started researching it and got some books about it. There's like listservs. That's not even a thing anymore, but there was a Hammond organ listserv, which I joined and read every post, every email, and then slowly found the path to like the great organist, Jimmy Smith. Jack McDuff. Groove Holmes. Thank you. got their records and sort of got into the scene slowly.
While I was waiting for you, because you were delayed on the train, I went into your Instagram feed and saw you posted after Dr. Lonnie Smith died, mm-hmm. that you spent a lot of time with him right around that time. I mean, you said from 14 to 18 or something
exactly.
like that. So you mm-hmm. pretty quickly you found one of the great masters to study
yes.
with.
Yes, I went to a jam session in Rhode Island where another great organist, Lonnie Gasparini, was, and he saw that I was interested. So he gave me Lonnie's number and said, you have to go take a lesson with him. I'll tell him that you're coming. So my parents would drive me to New York once or twice a year, and we would do what was supposed to be a two-hour lesson, but it would really be all day. And we would just like hang out and play duo. And then he would take me to either his show or to the jam session in Harlem, which I don't know if it exists anymore, but at the American Legion,
mm-hmm.
Where there's an organ. And yeah, I got to sit next to him and then watch him play. And it's just so different to see it live than to hear it.
It's one of those instruments that a lot of people flirt with. But if you're really going to play it, not unlike the harmonica, it's actually like joining a kind of exclusive little club.
Yeah, very much. I think it has to do with the bass and the pedals. That's the difference.
So did you feel like at some point you were joining this membership, you were gaining membership access to this club? I mean, did you spend time with other organ players as well?
Lonnie was the main one that I studied with when I was coming up. Now I'm friends with Larry Goldings, yeah. which is feels amazing because he was an idol of mine before I knew him. But yeah, I feel like I was in the club and now I sort of am, but I'm just not putting in the time anymore to really work on it.
Like, do you have an organ?
Yeah, I do.
So, and let's talk about it. At some point you also found the harmonica, which is again, another one of these kind of like special cases of a special case.
Much easier than organ.
Is it?
Yeah. There's only one thing happening at a time. Yeah, I heard Toots Thielemans. Just got one. You can get a bad one for like $20
mm-hmm.
and mess with it for a long time. And it slowly got better. And that's all. It took probably 5 years of being not very good. And now I'm not very good.
Did you study it in earnest at all? Or this is kind of a self-taught
I've never
thing?
Taken a lesson.
Yeah.
But I've definitely worked at it a lot.
Yeah.
But it's been more of just a fun thing to wrap my mind around. Just a different way of seeing notes.
What do you think is the difference, the distinction between playing piano and organ? If you're a great piano player, it does not necessarily, independent of the bass, I mean, even if you're not going to play pedals,
mm-hmm.
it doesn't necessarily translate. What? How do you think about them differently?
That's a good question. It's like, it's about the way you hit the keys. It's a completely different feeling. And you can tell when it's a pianist playing organ. Lonnie would always talk about that, how like, that's not, you don't want to be a pianist
sound
playing
like that,
organ.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's just about listening to organ and emulating the greats. You sort of learn how your hand is supposed to feel by chasing the sound.
Yeah. Years ago, an organ player named Bill Boblitz told me that he thought the difference was that the piano is about the downstroke and the organ is about the release. It's about how quickly you release your hand.
The keys are super light, so if you're using any sort of strength going down, it's not the vibe.
It's not the vibe.
Yeah.
So you went to Berklee College of Music.
Yeah, I went to New School first for 2 years.
Oh, you
then
did?
Transferred to Berklee. Yeah.
What were you studying at the New School?
Jazz. Piano.
Why'd you transfer?
It was a small school that was very specifically focused, sort of a modern jazz thing, which I was never really into. I didn't at the time really know the difference, I guess, but growing up I was into Jimmy Smith and stuff, and that's not what New School was. Probably no music schools are really that. So I just got
You got to move to Cleveland to get that, basically. Or Cincinnati.
Yeah, so I just felt pretty disillusioned with jazz eventually, and I felt sort of lost, wasn't really having fun. And then someone said that they were going to transfer to Berklee to learn production, and I thought, that sounds like a good idea, so I did that. And that's when I met a lot of great singer-songwriters, and that sort of switched my whole thought process.
I think one of the things that I really respond to about what you're doing is that you clearly have a deep relationship with jazz. You play And again, on your social media pages, every now and then you drop these like bombs, like here's a tape of me playing with Roy Hargrove. Here's the an anecdote about playing in Ralph Peterson's band. You know, this is some serious mentorship that you came through in Boston to then ultimately...
Reject it all.
It's in there though, man. You know, it's deeply in there.
Thanks.
And I feel that you kind of represent a generation of people who are kind of post-jazz in the sense that jazz becomes a way of traveling. It becomes like a language that you can apply in all of these other ways, you know?
Totally.
I think you have a lot of reverence and respect for it.
Definitely.
And in some ways, maybe that's why you choose not to play it.
Yeah, there's a lot of that. I always feel like I'm close to being... the real thing, but I'm not the real thing, and I never will be in straight ahead jazz. So the best thing that I can do for it is to take what I've learned from it and do my own thing.
That's interesting. What is the real thing, and why are you not it? You describe a lot of mentorship and information that was passed down one to one, which I think is the real thing.
Yeah, I think I didn't really start working at it the way that I would have needed to until a bit late. Maybe with organ, I could have been. But I feel like I only really learned how to fully respect and learn music in my late teens. And the people who are the real thing, like, were on that from early childhood in jazz. That's how I feel. Of course, there are exceptions, but...
I think that's a dangerous way to think, man. I mean, I know that thinking intimately. But I think we're so attached to this idea of some kind of a prescribed timeline with the stuff. And I think for every example, you know, Charlie Parker died in his 30s, right? But then there are all these other examples of people who came to stuff super late and made their mark. But I also totally know what you mean. Like, there is a kind of a reality that you're constantly having to check yourself against and ask, is this where I should be? Is this what I should be doing? Is this the right space for me?
Yeah. Also, it just doesn't feel right to be on a jazz gig. Feels like once in a while I'll really approach that thing I'm looking for, but most of the time I just feel out of place on the jazz bandstand.
So you met singer-songwriters at Berklee.
Mm-hmm.
You got into production.
Yeah.
You met Abe Rounds.
I actually didn't meet him there.
Really?
I met him. We were there at the same time for 2 years, and I met him later. That's how big the school is.
Huh. So who did you meet?
I met Nick Hakim. Sid Sriram. And Adrian Linker. Those people were there at the same time, and it was amazing. Like, everyone was forming their sound, and I was just a part of the group of friends. We didn't really feel like it was a movement or something. It was just people hanging out and writing songs and trying to figure it out, and now people are doing great.
When I was growing up, I'm in my mid-40s, so when I was growing up, like, Michael McDonald was legitimately on the radio, so it was Huey Lewis and, you know, a lot of yacht rock and a lot of, like, synth-oriented. Phil Collins was, like, a massive star when I was growing up. Completely unironically and totally informed my music, musical taste, like, the first time around. So much so, I think, that there was a kind of rejection among my peers of a lot of those sounds.
Totally.
And they came around again just behind me.
Must have been frustrating.
It is frustrating because I love that stuff.
Yeah.
There are plenty of sins that were committed, but there were also some incredible, you know, beautiful things that happened. And I had to, like, pretend that I didn't dig that for a really long time. Mm-hmm. And now I hear where you're coming out of 10 to 15 years behind, and it's like there's a total embrace of that palette.
Yeah, definitely. I think it mainly comes from liking harmony and finding already created palettes that have great harmony going on. That's what I think of when I think of Michael McDonald and and those sounds. Also, I remember hating 80s sounds for a long time and sort of then it clicking that there's great music with all sounds and you just have to find it. And it's a fun challenge to use sounds that maybe don't feel warm and still make something that does feel warm with the combination.
And were you doing that in Berklee or is that something that's come
That's after? Been more recent. I think my last album, Jake Sherman Gets Sexy, was the first time that I was like going more towards 80s things.
I can't believe it. Hadn't talked in a couple of months. Just saw the number, didn't know who it was. But those words you sent me can only mean a couple of things. I'll answer gently and see what it brings. The oldest remedy, yes, I feel the same. I'll be at your door for a midnight escapade.
But definitely my first things sounded like 70s.
Mm-hmm. And more guitar oriented.
Yeah,
more,
yeah. More acoustic instruments.
That's what I was feeling when I listened to your the record from 2016 is like Here Comes?
Jake Sherman Returns.
Jake Sherman Returns, exactly. Mostly an acoustic record, but then every now and then you drop these like electro surprises in the middle of it. So you were flirting with it a little
bit. Yeah, yeah. That song, Let's Be Friends, was my first time. I felt like that sounded like the 80s, although now I don't think it does. But it was my first time making a bright palette.
It feels so right, I'll just sit still. Remember this, I always will. A pity that each moment drifts away again. Let's be friends.
I thought you must be an LA person because so much, I guess maybe video content of you is in LA, both your like association with more recently with Scary Pockets, your Jake and Abe project with Abe Rounds, the Stories thing, which is like a Scary Pockets adjacent thing.
Yeah, yeah.
So much LA presence in your public facing life.
Yeah, I guess that happened because I started this band with Abe and then I started going out there to hang out with him and write with him and met a bunch of people there. When you're traveling somewhere that's not your home, you're motivated to like do something every day and meet people. Whereas when you're at home, you have to carve out that space because you also want to like do the laundry or whatever. So I made a lot of connections quickly in LA. Also because Abe is like a people person. So just hanging around with him, we would just be out meeting people all the time. And everyone respects him and loves him. So just being around him allowed me to make connections in a way that I didn't do here as quickly, I guess.
How did you two connect?
We connected because Meshell and Ndegeocello has a James Baldwin project, songs that are written either using his words or influenced by him in some way. And she called me to play in that a few years ago. And he's her drummer. So I met him through that.
And how did you meet Meshell?
She was playing this one sort of random gig at her son's music school, and they needed a band, so I was recommended. And of course, like it happened, like I got the call at 10 p.m., like tomorrow is the rehearsal, come to it, and here's all the songs. So I stayed up all night deciding like, okay, I'm going to make the best impression I can.
Were you a fan?
I wouldn't say I really knew her stuff on that level, but definitely a fan. Yeah, so it worked out well enough, and we became friends, and I'm very grateful to know her.
When was that you met her?
Probably 6 years ago or something.
My friend Alan Hampton had been playing with her. Was that same period?
Or was I don't know if he was playing with her then, but I know him well because I played keys for Andrew Bird for a while.
Oh, right.
He's on that gig.
So you guys were on the road together?
Yep.
Cool.
Yeah.
I just saw him in Paris in October. He's there for the year.
Cool. Yes, I saw him too.
Oh, I'm playing with him in May, actually.
Cool. Where?
At the Sunset in Paris.
Oh, great.
He was here and then he went out to LA, so you knew him when he was already in LA, or was
yes,
he?
Yes, I knew him in LA.
But he'd been working with Meshell. So you met Abe in Meshell in Ndegeocello's gig, realized that you had both been at Berklee at the same time.
Yes,
probably
exactly.
Had some mutual friends.
Right. And just that gig was a week long in the same place, and we hit it off. You know, we would be jamming in between and talking, and then we wrote a song, and then we had a band.
Do you see the songs that you write with him as somehow different lyrically or tonally from the stuff that you write yourself?
Sometimes. It depends. There's a couple different writing styles that we do. There's been a few songs. Well, there's a bunch of songs that aren't out yet, so there's only four that people have heard. But there's some of those songs that I wrote basically myself, mm-hmm. which do sound, I'd say, like my songs, but maybe more fleshed out. But then we write together. Sometimes he starts the idea and we finish it. And those sound very different than my songs in a really cool way. And a few songs that we really wrote together, and those sound different too.
Take a moment to greet the day. Everything is going a-okay. It's not often that I can say it's easy. Take a deep breath, inhale the air. Let it out again without a care. Run around and feel the wind in my hair. It's easy.
One thing that I was noticing when I was listening to your songs is how many songs you've written with women's names in the title.
Yep.
Isabel, I don't even know you well yet, but I can tell that 'cause of you the world has changed, and now you're part of everything. Maureen, as I lie awake you dream, the castle crumbling to sand. As we drift away to sea.
Is that something that you realized was becoming a habit and then leaned into, or is that just an accident of life? What is that?
I mean, I guess there's a bunch of songs that exist already that are like that. So I was just modeling it after my idols. The Beatles have some. There's an Elvis Costello song that I loved.
Allison?
Yes, I love that song. Very dark song.
Incredible.
So I guess it just felt natural because I've really checked out some songs that are like that. And it's just always a great chorus to have a name.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, it wasn't that conscious, really.
How do you think about what you're going to write about? When you got sexy, it seemed like you were going to kind of be sexy. But as you say, you're not sure if you're taking it seriously or not.
Yeah. I like to stay on that line, I guess. How do I know what I'm going to write about? I think it just naturally happens. If I try to consciously force it, it doesn't usually get finished. So I don't know the answer.
I feel a pretty big chasm between your personal vibe in the space and your stage dynamic. Like,
but
you seem to like really flower on stage and you're pretty chill in the room. You know what I mean? Like, you seem like a very kind of almost like a slightly introverted person.
Definitely. I feel introverted.
Do you feel more extroverted when you're on stage? Do you feel more comfortable on stage?
Yeah, I guess so. I remember the first show I ever played, like, that was my music that I was singing, and I just was able to be like that. It felt natural, and I sort of couldn't believe that it was happening. And that was one of the clues that this is what I should be doing. It felt so easy and real, the talking to the audience part, versus like a jazz gig where it's like, that was a beautiful ballad by John Coltrane. I couldn't be that person for real.
Also, you have a really high range when you sing, and your spoken voice is kind of low.
I've been working on singing a lot. And thank you, that's very nice, but that's definitely the hardest instrument.
Your voice?
Yeah, way harder than organ.
You have spent a lot of time developing this kind of vocoder style,
mm-hmm.
where your voice is kind of part of the pad and part of the texture.
Don't go changing to try and please me.
never let me down before. Oh no, baby, don't imagine. Ooh, you're too familiar, and I don't see you anymore. Ooh, I would not leave you in times of trouble, no. We never could have come this far. I took the good times, I'll take the bad times, I'll take you just the way you are.
Where did that get developed? What were you thinking about?
That came from Blue Dubbity Dubba Die by Eiffel 65.
I'm Blue Dubbity Dubba Die.
That was the first like auto-tune type sound I ever heard, and I knew I wanted it. And it was years before I got a vocoder, but that was in my mind for like 10 years. And then the vocoder just, I had always been messing around with pitch bend, so yeah. I felt fairly comfortable doing that kind of soloistic thing, but just without the voice. So it just clicked immediately.
What are you actually using like when you play live?
It's a MIDI keyboard going into a vocoder pedal.
It's just a vocoder pedal?
Mm-hmm.
What's the source and what's the source tone that you send to the vocoder pedal?
The pedal has the source in it.
Oh, it does.
So it's connected with a MIDI cable. This is classified information.
Can I share this with people?
Yes, you can share this.
It's hard.
I'm not saying the pedal's name unless you repost my video. Not you, but the person who's asking for it.
I see. I remember when Jacob Collier, who I know you've spent some time with, and mm-hmm. we should talk about that as well, when he first started unleashing his instrument that he developed with MIT.
Yes. You're talking about the vocoder sounding thing.
Yeah,
the vocoder. I'm pretty sure that's autotune. Like, basically autotune. Like, you press a key and it tunes the voice to that.
There's some video of you hanging out with Jacob.
Mm-hmm.
How did you guys connect?
He saw my vocoder thing, and I think he commented on it. That was how we first met. And then, yeah, we just send each other weird music things every, like, 6 months. And then he was in New York, and we managed to... We had like half an hour where we were both free, so I went there and we did a Christmas song.
What does the internet mean to you in terms of how you connect with people? Is it your primary source of connection with people?
I'd say yes. It's definitely a love-hate thing. I recently deleted Instagram for some time.
Why?
Like, because it felt like I was not really able to be fully there in real life. And I was just checking it way too much, you know? I think all of us have that going on. Just wanted to experiment with that feeling of not having it. And it definitely changes your outlook. It was also very depressing at first to have no source of dopamine from the phone. And now I have it again, but probably need to delete it again. Both ways now feel depressing, having it and not having it.
I mean, when you're promoting things, it's really hard not to.
Totally. I guess lately I haven't been posting, so that also feels weird to open it and have nothing going on.
That's where I'm at with it right now.
Yeah.
I'm not posting very much. And yeah, then you get to experience it for what it is without the dopamine.
Yeah.
Which is interesting.
And I realize I don't care about almost everything.
I know.
It's meaningless. And then once in a while, there's something really cool. And then I feel like, oh, this is worth it.
I think for what we do, it is helpful in terms of putting pieces together. Who knows who plays with who, what, you know,
totally.
Discovering certain things.
Mm-hmm.
You discover them much more quickly.
And connections with people is, there's no substitute.
I mean, you are here because of it. And
exactly.
You didn't even reach out to me. You just followed me. And I reached out to you and said, I've been wanting to talk to you. I can't believe you followed me.
Yeah, I was teaching a lesson to my friend Ty McHugh. Uh-huh. Do you know that guy?
No, who is that?
He's a friend, and I did this tour of house shows in the U.S., and he organized one of them. But anyway, he sent me your podcast and said, you should be on this. So then I checked it out, and then I followed you, and that's what happened.
Did he have a specific episode that he thought?
Well, he just wanted me to look at the names.
Yeah.
And it's like at least 50% of the people are my friends.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it is interesting where it sort of reveals itself over time, like who you should talk to. And again, Instagram is helpful with that. So
yeah.
it's a very real thing.
Definitely.
And yet it's all completely fake thing also.
Yeah. I find that it lowers the bar for artistry, which is really dangerous. Like when you see things that are doing well that aren't good. Like, it makes you think, okay, well, I can do this. Let me do that. Let me just spend a little time making this kind of video and I'll get likes. And the hope is that you do like a viral type thing and then your career is solved, basically.
Yeah, I guess that's the hope. Okay, you do a viral thing and then your career is solved. But the people that I see that are really doing it, it's like, that's the job. The job is actually making the videos.
Right. But there's just a lot of videos that do well that aren't, you know, like that don't compare to like an album from the 60s or 70s that we love. That's where the bar is. And that's what I want to do. So I'm sort of struggling with the dichotomy of like, how do I stay engaged and involved and make content, but have it be all of the quality that it needs to be for me to be happy?
But you want to be successful in 1975.
Yeah, exactly.
How did you hook up with Larry Goldings?
I met him a long time ago. I had a lesson with him, but I was too nervous, so I wasn't able to show him that I was good because I was trying to show him I was good. That doesn't work. And then later, when my first album came out, I sent him one of the songs that had the craziest chords of the songs on the album, and he responded and loved it. So we became friends from that. That was pre-Instagram. Yeah, so we've been talking ever since. And then more recently, I started hanging with him in LA when I would be there. It's been amazing to have it go from like an idol to a friend who's still an idol.
It's funny because there's a video that the two of you made last year that's, I think, just called Jake Sherman and Larry Goldings Play the Blues, yes, or something like that, mm-hmm, which in my mind must have like 6 million views. And then I look and it's, I don't know, it's 10,000 viewers or something.
Yeah,
whatever.
It's less than that.
It's, yep, not, it's not that many. And it's just like such a hit for me when I saw this. This is a hit, you know. And it's a hit in some ways because of how unstructured and chaotic it is. It just seems like two likely stoned people, or at least maybe possibly one likely stoned person.
Yes, definitely.
Walking around a room, trying on different instruments and playing the blues.
We did. It was a Twitch stream.
I want to.
Yeah, I got into Twitch over the pandemic, and then he did too. I helped him a bit with setting that up, as others helped me. So we did that from his room and did like an hour and a half long show, basically, where we were just walking around the room playing, and that was one of the better takes, so I published it.
Let's talk about Twitch for a second here. Cool. I'm not like, I'm avoiding it. I talked to Michael Mayo about it earlier this year.
That's my vocal teacher.
Oh, is it?
Yes. It's been amazing. It's changed my life.
Oh, he's so incredible.
Yep.
He's incredible.
100%.
And
recommend.
He's a Twitch guy.
Yes, he's a Twitch guy. The Twitcher.
Are you a gamer?
No. I was mainly using it for producing, like producing stuff and having people watch me produce.
Right.
The Larry thing was the only actual show that I did on it, pretty much.
I saw a video of, one of a few. You and Abe producing a song on Twitch, how you almost got kicked off.
Exactly.
It's different to produce in a performative way. Do you find that it changes the way you approach it if you have to do it while people are watching you?
Yeah, good question. Sometimes a bit. It makes me do less takes, which is helpful actually, because, you know, if it's not good in the first few takes, it's not going to be good usually. It had a lot of positive impacts. It made me really get the setup to be 100% efficient. Mm-hmm. If it's not already plugged in and ready to go, it can't be used because people are watching you and you don't want to be like, okay, let me just figure out, okay, there's no sound. Just give me a second. And you have to be like narrating. You don't want to narrate as you're just unable to make a noise.
Well, you're narrating the whole time. I'm going to do this. I have an idea now. I'm going to slow it down half speed, play the solo. And then when I speed it up, I'll be playing twice as fast. What, you know, I saw you make a couple of choices in the moment where I was like, okay, those are cool. Not a lot of room for experimenting, though, right? Like, do you have to have done your experimenting off Twitch so that you can...
I mean, so that was a 20-minute video, and that actual session was 8 hours long.
Uh-huh.
It was cut down.
So you live-streamed it on Twitch for 8 hours making the song.
Yeah, and then it saves the video. You download the video, and you just chop to make a YouTube. It's just a separate process. Yeah, that's how... Usually, my Twitches would be that long.
You say, I'm going to the bathroom?
Yeah, I just put up a screen that says, in bathroom, be right back. Yeah, it was great to like organize my time. Like, okay, I'm going to be working these 8 hours, so let me like make a list of things I need to get done and try to do them. But the narrating felt pretty easy. I guess it felt a little like being on stage, sort of a cross between it. But yeah, there was definitely a lot of experimenting in the 8 hours. Like that part where I played the solo slowed down so that I could speed it up later, that came after like 6 takes of the solo at normal speed, where it was just each one was like, it's not right. So people had to sit through, I don't know, 40 minutes before I got that. But people like that, I think.
I think they love that. I mean, on the one hand, I feel like maybe what it is it's a response to the fact that now we're all self-contained. And ultimately, in the 70s and the 80s, when these records that we admire so much were being made, you could spend a day singing takes, but
right.
There was somebody on the other side of the glass that was operating for you, and there was probably also totally. A producer. And so even that, even if you're just performing for a couple of people, there's an accountability because it's like
yes.
somebody else's life is impacted here, mm-hmm. you know? And now we're just sitting at home, we're doing as many takes as we want, and I think maybe there's something refreshing about just knowing that people are watching you and being held accountable.
Right. Yeah, it's a whole different thing. Yeah, held accountable, I guess, is a good phrase for it, especially with singing. It's like, okay, can I really do this? Let's find out.
Well, I was very impressed with your singing on that video, and there's a purity in your voice that almost sounds like it can't possibly be happening. Like it must be, you know, you must be tweaking it and tweezing it and doctoring it. And then I saw you sing. I was like, no, that's how he sings. He sings in tune, motherfucker.
Thank you.
I guess Michael Mayo has been part of the process.
Yes, huge part.
So what do you work on with him?
I bring a song. I bring one part of a song, a very specific thing that I've never been able to nail in a performance. And it's sort of crazy to even think that that's a thing. Like, that wouldn't exist on piano to me.
Mm-hmm.
Like, having sung a song in a performance 50 times and being aware that every single time I just sing this part badly.
Mm-hmm.
That's so crazy. But yeah, that's been the biggest thing is really being honest with myself about those moments and then taking them to him and getting into the minutia of how to make that tone on that note. And that's it.
Did you ever take a lesson with Theo Blechman?
I didn't, no. It's been recommended, though. I probably should.
Yeah,
but I've taken many vocal lessons, and almost all of them have been either led me in the wrong direction or just not fully gotten there. And Michael is pretty much the first person who it's fully clicked with. So I don't think I want to take lessons from other people, really, because I feel like I can get what I need from him.
What is teaching like for you? Who do you teach? What do you teach? Where does that fit in your life?
I teach a lot, between 4 and 8 lessons a week. It feels like a lot sometimes. I find it easier to teach people who are pretty good already. Maybe that's how it always is. But yeah, I like when people come to me with specifics.
Like you come to Michael.
Exactly. The more people know about what they want to do, the easier it is to get them there.
And so what do they come with? What kinds of things do people come with?
Usually we work on piano technique or expanding harmony stuff. I think those have been the more successful lessons. I've taught some like songwriting lessons, but that's a little, I don't really know how to teach that. All I can do is say, well, here's what I would do. And then I like
then
finish
co-writing.
The song.
Yeah, exactly.
And then they're like, oh, that sounds awesome.
Yeah.
But I don't know how to teach how to get there besides teaching harmony, I guess, and song form.
Yeah. Do you think that that's part of the pop music space today, song form?
To me, that's what makes or breaks a song. It's like the most important. The way I write is first I'll write a section or two, maybe 3, and not really worry about the form. And then when I have them, I figure out how they fit together.
Yeah.
And yeah, you just know when a song's form is wrong. It might sound like the chorus is good, but you're bored by the end or something mm-hmm. like that. But when it's really right, you're like riveted the whole time, assuming that the sections are good.
Are you also still studying with other people? Or have you?
No.
No.
I don't really practice keys anymore, but I practice singing all the time and I'm accompanying myself. So I'm playing a lot of keys.
So you made it a priority at some point. I want to work on my singing because I'm out here.
Yeah, I just realized that like this is not going to work unless I can sing at the highest level. And it took me a while to realize that. For a long time, I was thinking, like, I know I have an honesty, so I should just do it, and it's going to work. But it took really listening back to it and being like, is this really what I want it to sound like? And also, people always told me I was good at singing, and that's very dangerous to hear.
Mm.
So I've always encouraged people to not believe it when people say you're good.
Do you... Yeah, wait, I started talking, but what you just said is actually really heavy. I've always encouraged people to not believe it when they're told that they're good.
Yeah, you have to just listen back. Is it really good? You know if it's good. Is it what you want it to be?
It's a very big question, right? Like, I have known and know a lot of immensely talented people, most of whom are unsatisfied.
Hmm.
I mean, I think that dissatisfaction is actually a big part of what keeps people improving.
Totally.
And makes them good in the first place.
Yep.
I sometimes feel that if you meet somebody who is totally satisfied with what they're doing, they are not to be trusted and to be avoided at all costs. On the other hand, there's something extremely healthy about identifying when you get it sounding good yourself. And you're like, no, that is good. That is what I want.
Right. And that's part of what I'm saying. There, it is. I know a lot of people, like, it's very unhealthy to just be like, oh, I suck.
Yeah.
That's not what I mean. I mean, just being honest, like, there's plenty of things I do that are great. And there's plenty of notes I sing that are great. But when they're not great, you have to really dig into why they're not great, or you're not going to get better.
A friend of mine wrote to me today, or yesterday, a very talented friend who I admire enormously wrote to me and said that he had just discovered somebody else, another discovery of somebody I also had discovered at some point. And he said, you know, I'm feeling overwhelmed by the vast amount of talent around me.
Hmm.
That it's just sometimes feels self-defeating to be out here trying to make music, knowing how much great stuff is out there.
Mm-hmm.
And like that really, you know, resonated with me. I agree with that. I feel like I don't have another option. I want to make music, and yet I'm tortured knowing that there's so much great stuff out there at the same time. That holding those two in balance is part of the challenge.
Yeah, I think it's about finding your own lane. If you really do, then you know that no one else is going to quite do that.
Yeah.
And if you don't, you'll always have that feeling of inferiority. I think Instagram also leads to that feeling for sure, which is why it can be healthy to delete it.
I interviewed somebody recently who worked years ago at CBGB's doing sound, and he said it was the great thing about it was that if he heard a fantastic show, he went home and wrote a song.
Hmm.
And if he heard a terrible show, he went home and wrote a song.
Mm-hmm.
That both of them motivated him and inspired him.
Yeah.
And I definitely relate to that feeling of being so overwhelmed by somebody's talent that you are both depressed and inspired by it.
Right. Yeah. I've thought about that a lot. How often if you hear someone who's really good, it makes you depressed.
Yeah.
But if you hear someone who's even better, who's transcendent, you don't have any of that depression. You have like just inspiration that like everything is limitless. Especially in jazz, I really feel that, how almost everyone is really good, and it makes me feel like, oh, I can't even play this. This is dumb. I should quit.
Yeah.
But then when you really hear someone who's just beyond it, it's like, this is what I love about life.
Yes. Because it represents the potential of life, human potential.
Mm-hmm.
It's so vast.
It's not about regurgitating or playing fast or whatever.
Yeah. So do you feel that you found your lane, or you're finding your lane?
Yeah, for sure. Writing songs and singing them feels right.
What is success for you right now?
That's a very good question. I'm not sure. The tour was successful, but then it felt like the next step was to have another tour, a bigger tour, which I got, and it just got canceled. So now, I don't know. I really don't know. I guess I sort of have two different worlds, the producing from home world and the touring world, and I haven't fully figured out how they fit together.
You were supposed to open for Scary Pockets. There were a lot of dates, pretty big rooms.
Yeah, biggest rooms I would have played as a singer, for sure.
Solo? You were going to do solo?
Yep. Mm-hmm.
With the kick, drum, pedal, and the hi-hat, or just all down to keyboard?
I think it would have been with the kick thing. It doesn't really work to do the full solo show if it's not a piano.
Yeah.
If it's a whirly, I don't know if I'm ready yet to just play whirly and sing.
Uh-huh. The piano gives you more...
Yeah, like there's more lows, more highs. It's just a more expansive sound. Yeah. Whirly is very sort of mono and boxy.
But funky.
Yeah, for sure.
Because when I saw you with the whirly and the vocoder and the kick and the hat, what I was going to say to you is, I think there's a Jake Sherman record that feels like Donny Hathaway live. Mm. Like, I think that's the record I want to hear from you.
That's a goal, for sure.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
That organic thing. And one thing I really admire about you is that you're so soulful and you're such a great singer, and you don't overtly mimic soul singers in the way you sing. That you found a way to stay authentic to who you are. You're a great singing white kid from Boston who like isn't pretending to be a different kind of singer or person.
Yeah.
And I feel that authenticity and like honesty that I have struggled with. And I know a lot of people who love black music have struggled mm-hmm. with in our own singing.
Yeah. I guess I'm very conscious of that. And yeah, I guess I just know when it feels not honest. It's just such an immediate cringe when I hear other people do that in a lot of things, like in mainly in pronunciation of words, I'd say, and vocal tone. Just there's certain things that I don't want to be.
I mean, for some people, it totally works. I mean, it can also completely work. And,
right.
And I think voices are colorless in many ways. And like if it's whatever the authentic version of right. your voice is, but you can sort of feel when it's forced or when it's not.
Right. And I've wondered about how that is in keys playing, because it's like the line is much more blurred, you know, of what's mimicking. Whereas in vocals, like, it's so clear.
And that's a hard question, right? And it's such a fine line between mimicking and being influenced by, right?
Right. And I think giving all the respect
yeah.
you can to the source, to the black music source, is what will get you there.
Yes. But I hear all the respect in your playing. I mean, because it's so motivated by love. It's obviously coming out of so much love.
Yeah.
You crave authenticity in your vocal approach. You crave mm-hmm. authenticity in your playing. You crave honesty in, you know, what you're doing. But you also, you love the surrealist comedy. You love the out there images. You cite Weird Al as one of your major influences. Mm-hmm. I mean, not that that's inauthentic, but right. like it may not really tell us who you are.
Well, I've always liked making people laugh, so I think it's an authentic part of me. It's how I am normally. So I think it fits.
Let's talk about what Weird Al did for you and then, you know, where that led you.
Sure. Yeah, I think I have a unique relationship to him because I basically had no pop culture reference. So I hadn't heard any of the songs before. For those of you who don't know, he makes parodies of songs. So it's songs, famous songs with new lyrics, with funny new lyrics.
I know they're all thinking I'm so wide and nerdy. Think I'm just too wide and nerdy. Think I'm just too wide and nerdy. Can't you see I'm wide and nerdy? Look at me, I'm wide and nerdy. I wanna roll with the gangsters, but so far they all think I'm too wide and nerdy. Think I'm just too wide and nerdy. Think I'm just too wide and nerdy.
Skills, I'm a champion of D&D. MC Escher, that's my favorite MC. Keep your 40 out, just have
an... Still, all the time, I'll be like in a grocery store and hear a song. And I'm like, how do I know this song? Oh, it's the Weird Al song. Oh, this is the original song.
And you still didn't know the original song?
Still didn't know. It happens all the time. I had his first 10 albums, so that's like over 100 songs that I was obsessed with and listened to all the time. So I think, I don't know how many of me there are who actually don't know the real songs, but I think that's where a lot of my production and knowledge of pop culture came from, getting it filtered down and hearing the most popular songs of every year for 10 years. All of these were older, by the way. It wasn't that I was into them for 10 years. It was that it was like a 2-year period where I had all the albums and just...
Right. And so yeah. that's where you soaked up kind of the language of pop music.
Exactly.
Was through his filter of what pop yes. music was.
But the productions are amazing. Like they sound pretty much identical.
But with more accordion.
Yeah.
A little more accordion.
Yeah. The later albums don't even have it. He just completely got the production the same.
And what about other comedy?
Well, the first comedy record I had was Dr. Demento. Do you know about him? Mm-hmm. He was like a radio host who gave Weird Al his start.
Uh-huh.
So this is like a compilation of all these things. So that's where I discovered Weird Al. And there were a few other funny ones, but I guess I was really into the music and almost all the other comedy people were lacking in the musical parts. So I couldn't get down.
Later on, there was like Flight of the Conchords, that kind of thing.
Yeah, I love that. I still felt like the music didn't do it for me, though. It is really funny, the show. I love the show. But yeah, the Weird Al was just all the way there. Like, he also writes originals, half the songs are originals.
Uh-huh.
And like, the harmony is amazing. It's got it all.
Talking about humor is probably the only thing that's worse than talking about what makes something funky or beautiful musically.
Right.
I mean, it's very hard to talk about humor.
Yeah.
You kill
what
it when
something
you talk
funny?
About it.
Yeah, yeah, hard to know.
When I listen to recordings of gigs that I have played where I sing, I generally fast forward through the songs and listen to my banter and see if I got any laughs. Like I want to be a comedian, I think.
Right, right.
And it's like an enormous amount of work to have to get on stage and travel and write all these songs and put a band together and do all this stuff just to get
just to say some jokes. Yeah. I always feel like if people are laughing in between the songs, then the show is good, no matter what. I guess maybe I'm coming around to now caring about the songs a bit more, but the overall feeling of the gig, if the banter is awkward, there's no way that it's going to be a successful show.
I suppose the next thing would be, and I've seen it, where your lyrics can get that same kind of response from people.
Yeah.
You know?
They do often.
Yeah.
It was interesting to play them in Europe where people weren't understanding them. It was very off-putting at first, but I got used to it. And that also helped me focus on the music part.
Did you feel a difference in the audiences when you went to Europe?
People were more excited to see someone from America, I guess. There was that. Yeah, it just feels less normal to have, like, I don't know what kind of music it is that I do, but it feels like something like that can be found in New York in a variety of places and maybe not in Germany or something.
Right. Do you think about moving to LA?
Yeah, I tried it twice. Not a full move, but I tried going there for a month at a time. And both times it just didn't feel great. It felt too sunny, too sad.
Too sunny and too sad.
Yep.
Why is it so, what do you mean sad?
I don't know. I just felt a bleakness. I felt like there's a lot of like writing rooms, like people getting together and forcing out songs, yeah. And like top liners. That phrase is just very cringy and scary to me. No offense to people who do that. But it just doesn't feel like the way that I write or interact with music. Of course, there's tons of great things happening there, but I think that's a big part of the music scene there, is like writing hits. And of course I want to write hits, but maybe not those kind of hits. I'm not sure. And the weather's too nice all the time.
You say, of course I want to write hits. You know, I mean, that it's a huge question, what it means to write hits. How do you pursue writing hits? Is that something you want to do? You know, mm-hmm. I want to write hits, but not those kind of hits. Maybe there are other hits to be written. I think there probably are.
Yeah, there's plenty of music that is popular that has crazy chords.
Yeah, totally.
For me to like badmouth it is really just me feeling like I want to be further in my career or something.
Right. You know? I mean, what is your life like? What does a day in your life look like? How do you structure your life?
Well, it varies a lot. I was on the road for 2 months, 1 month for the Europe tour, and then 1 month playing in Nick Hakim's band. And I came back and had an extreme low for a variety of reasons. But one of the big ones is that being on tour is such a high and such a like unrealistic, crazy experience. And then coming back was just a much farther low than I thought would happen. And then this tour getting canceled sort of prolonged that, I guess. I just got a room for my instruments, like a separate studio. So I've been distracting myself by moving that and setting it up in the hopes that that will be like a workspace that I am able to produce from, and I might do Twitch again. I completely stopped doing Twitch in
the
summer.
It sounds like Twitch is good in that it forces you to go into a room and make something.
Exactly, yeah. It's nice to have a schedule. And also you can't like go on social media during that time.
Because you're streaming.
Yeah. Yeah, I was really into it like in the winter, and then it became summer and stuff opened up and there was gigs, and it felt like this is so dumb to be here on my computer for 8 hours when there's actually life outside again. But now maybe there's not as much life outside, and it really did have a lot of positive impacts. So I'm going to try it again when the space is set up. One of the things that I did was like critiquing people's half-finished songs on Twitch, which was really amazing. I would just advertise for a few days on Instagram that it was going to happen, and people would send their demos. And then it was probably the highest engagement on Twitch that I had. A lot of people would watch, and I would have like a guest or someone come do it with me, and we would just listen and say what it is that we would change about it or where we thought it could go. And it was so inspiring to hear things that people are making from their bedrooms. Like, usually it was, maybe there was one or two things that were like, ooh, this person like, or, you know, this person doesn't have a, whatever, that's not the point. What I should have said is flip it around. Almost 99% of the stuff was like inspiring and forward-thinking and honest and cool.
Did you feel that the people that were reaching out to you were influenced by you or?
Some were. Some weren't. There was a lot of different kinds of music, some that I didn't even know that much about, but I was just saying what I could about it. Like sometimes it would just be like mix type notes.
Yeah.
Sometimes it was form. Sometimes it was structure and sounds, just whatever I thought in the moment.
What does your family think of what you do?
I think they didn't get it for some time. I'm an only child, but my parents are classical musicians. And
both of them?
Yeah. My mom plays flute. I think they probably thought it was weird, or I know they did, especially because I couldn't sing at the beginning.
Hmm.
But they've seen it come a long way, and they've always been fully supportive. But I think at the beginning, they were, you know, my mom would half jokingly say, why don't you play, you should play jazz. You should still.
Oh, so they didn't get when you left jazz and started doing singer-songwriter production.
Yeah, or just why I would devote time to that when I already had a lane and I was already pretty far in it. Like, why backpedal? Which I understand, especially as a parent who wants their child to go far in whatever they're doing.
Do you still get called for jazz-adjacent things?
Once in a while, but I'm basically not doing most gigs now that are as a sideman. It's a conscious choice. Of course, there are some that are very dear to me that I'm still doing, but I think it's part of doing what you want to do is identifying what is keeping you from doing that time-wise.
And you identify that playing other people's music, mm-hmm. dealing with that was not.
Yeah, it just takes so much energy and time to play something at a high level. Not the gig, that's the least of it. It's the preparation.
I think about that a lot and how for so many, that is the top of the mountain. You know, you put in a lot of work to be able to play on a level so that when you get called, you can deliver.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe that's what your mom is talking about. You put in all this time and now you don't want to take the
gigs.
Right,
exactly. Well, I wasn't even not taking the gigs at that time, but just I was presenting myself as a singer, which was not at the level of my organ playing or whatever.
So when do you like? Do you think on your first record you could sing?
No, definitely not. Like the way it was recorded was not in a singerly way. I recorded like every phrase one at a time.
Right.
There's a lot of vocal tuning. Like I just couldn't do it yet.
Yeah.
And it wasn't until my most recent one that I could.
I mean, that opens up another can of worms, which is like you can make a record without being a singer.
Yeah, you can.
You can even deliver a convincing vocal performance on a record without being necessarily a singer.
Yeah, it wasn't until like I really tried to sing live in a real way that made me understand what it is to do it.
I think that's probably where I am, honestly.
That's where you are as a singer.
Yeah, but we're here to talk about you. What are you working on?
Well, I made an album of guitar-centered, more rock songs. I call it rock, but people who like rock don't call it rock. Soft rock, I guess. Yacht rock, maybe. And I'm trying to find the next step for how to release that. I think the next thing that's going to come out is a deluxe edition of Jake Sherman Get Sexy, which is going to have remixes from some of my idols and peers.
Talk about the record that you made, that you put out in 2020 with all these little short songs, a lot of harmonica.
Yeah, that was in my parents' house in Boston. My first ever tour of my own music was about to happen, or was underway. It was the fourth show when COVID happened. This is something I'd put together for months. I had to just cancel it all, obviously. So I picked up my girlfriend and we went home to my parents' house for what we thought would be 2 weeks, and it was 3 months. I also picked up a few keyboards from New York and set them up in a circle, and I coped with the loss of that tour by creating like, leading up to the tour, I wasn't doing any creation or really music making because it's all admin and booking. That's the only way until you have an agent. So it was a huge release to go home and actually make things. So I just made one or two songs a day for like 7 days, and that was it. Maybe more, sometimes three songs a day, but they were just little snippets. They didn't have lyrics. That made it much easier. I was able to crank them out, just like sing a voice memo idea and then make, like produce something, mainly first takes. Like everything was made in an hour or so. And then I spent maybe one more week doing little mix tweaks and figuring out the order and stuff.
It was just a way to just make something out of this dead time, out of this.
Yeah. And now it's one of the things I'm most proud of, I think. It really feels real because of the lack of editing.
Jake Sherman, I have wanted to meet you for a long time. Thank you so much for making it happen.
Thanks for having me. It's been great.
It's a real pleasure. Congratulations. I'm a big fan.
Thank you.
Jake Sherman.